And all right, as long as Kench is on the bench, everything is cool. And Varus is going to stay there as well.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see if Golden Guardians change up anything after the loss as far as pick ban. The bans so far are the same from both sides from last game. FlyQuest obviously making the adjustment after game number one where they did get dismantled.
Right.
But Golden Guardians, you know, a lot of people certainly expecting. We talked about the cast, the desk talked about it as well. Perhaps Froggen will go back to a more traditional style for him with the kind of farming late game carry, playing heavily four lane as he is so adept at that style.
Irelia, the final ban here for FlyQuest. Golden Guardians still one left to pick. And it will be Ryze, okay. Same bans as last time. So Golden Guardians not thinking that anything needs to be adapted so far.
Yeah, and I think that's totally fair as far as the bans go. We'll see if the picks do change. FlyQuest gonna lock in first pick Jace once more. I would be surprised to actually see Yorick come out, but it may be parity at least through those first picks.
Galio was picked up very early last time for the Golden Guardians. They'll do the same thing here again. And with the Jarvan. All right, so far, this draft is looking very, very similar to game two.
It is, right? And there are some things that we could see just changed up, slight adjustments. You know, Golden Guardians last time, actually, as Mark talked about, had the opportunity to ban out Swain. Maybe they say, hey, everything was great, it was just the Swain. And they want to run back the entire same draft, but just ban out Swain in second round. They could go for something like that.
Yep.
And also, we could see everything else changing around this. We could see different solo laners, different marksmen, which completely change how the draft functions and how these two teams will interact. But so far, first four picks the same, first six bans the same. I would be shocked to see an entire salty run back from Golden Guardians because it didn't feel like they had the answers last time.
Absolutely not. FlyQuest still one pick left to go. We'll see if they decide to continue to mirror the last game. That's definitely not what's going to be picked. Thank you. All right, Elise picked up and we are 5 for 5.
5 for 5, 6 for 6 on bans. Will it be the Lissandra coming through here as it did last time for the Golden Guardians? Not expecting it. I'm expecting, you know, something to be changed up here, whether they want to bring in, you know, perhaps even a more high-powered marksman, something that could deal with that. It will be Kalista.
Okay,
so this is a very powerful lane combo, especially post six, where you can actually throw in the Galio for that AoE taunt. It is also something which can really bully lanes and has early kill potential.
It was also banned out last game in the second phase because the Lissandra was picked at number three. AD carry had to be picked afterwards, which means that was banned away.
Okay, so Lucian going to be banned out. I'm interested to see, will they ban out Ezreal as well? And surprisingly, FlyQuest actually bans out the Yorick, so they don't want to have that Yorick matchup once again. A little bit interesting, because
yeah.
I mean, obviously they are still somewhat concerned about how it plays out, and yes, though it has not been working on stage, certainly it keeps showing up, so it's obviously working in scrims, right? And
yeah,
they know that, hey, maybe the Yorick would have succeeded had there been a different mid laner to be able to answer the Swain better. Probably some sort of thought process along those lines.
Well, we were also, for those of you who may be curious, or aren't curious, but you will be after I tell you this stat, Azale and I were looking at Yorick's game history throughout Spring Split, and over the course of 6 games from multiple different players, the champion has a grand KDA of 1.15-6 across those 6 different games.
Before last game.
Before last game. Mm-hmm. So that's averaging at under 0.5 KDA. The champion has been very underwhelming in NA so far. But FlyQuest, as Azale said, obviously don't want to deal with it this time around. And they will also not want to deal with the Golden Guardians Karthus here, as Golden Guardians does go for something more traditional in the top side with a Poppy. Swain is still available.
Yeah, so very interesting stuff here. So the Ezreal was banned out, as I did expect. But Poppy was also a phase 2 ban for FlyQuest last time. That was now actually available because they banned off the Yorick and the Karthus instead. So Poppy, you know, we did see this matchup actually, you know, Licorice played it versus Impact not too long ago. Licorice certainly was running that lane on the Poppy. We'll see if Haunter could be able to make similar things happen as Syndra does come through, and it will be counterpick here for Froggen. Karthus won't be available. Vayne gets locked in for Turtle.
Okay. Wild Turtle, a man known for being able to go aggressive and make some mechanical outplays. Well, here's a champ to do it on as the Golden Guardians will lock in Vel'Koz for Froggen. That is a Froggen champion.
Okay.
That is, I tagged you with Q and pressed R and you died.
Yep, this is a lot of damage. It's also backline access. you can be ulting past the Braum and killing the Vayne. So that is something that Turtle's gonna have to be very, very careful of. That being said, Vayne can deal well with these three frontliners who are gonna be coming at him. It's a lot of CC, but that being said, Cleanse is being taken, yes. And you can shred through tanks on Vayne with the true damage. You hit Blade of the Rune King plus Rage Blade, you will shred these guys, and you also have the ability to use Contract's ultimate against him. He throws down the Cataclysm, you can condemn him against that wall and turn around fights on him.
I like how much of a changeup this draft was, because it came in looking exactly like the first half of the draft from last game, and then the second half was just totally different in terms of what we got. And for Golden Guardians, they have to be thinking, all right, these are the changes that needed to be made. This is why we couldn't answer last time. We didn't have enough damage. The Swain was a problem. We didn't have a tank. Now those are fixed.
Yeah, very, very different in the latter part of the draft. First five were in parity, but certainly the way that these teams are going to interact is extremely different. When you bring in the Kalista against this Vayne, a lot of pressure going to be down there in the bottom lane. You know, for this Kalista to have early game success, to be able to put that Vayne on the back foot before Turtle can get to the stage where he can start to take over, and likewise for Froggen. This is not about roaming whatsoever on the Vel'Koz. It is about farming up, being powerful in those teamfights where we think Froggen is best.
Vel'Koz is like playing a turret. You're not super mobile, but you've got really long range. You do a ton of damage. You are the artillery. You are that long range cannon bringing the pain from all the way downtown. And Froggen is exactly the kind of player I would expect to do very well on a champion like this. Out onto the Rift for the third time today, and as has been tradition, Avely standing by with yet another sideline report.
Yes, tradition flowers. Invert, FlyQuest fans were probably a little nervous after that game one, but Pobelta really pulled it together in game two. So how was the team able to bounce back and pick up that win after the first game loss?
Well, in the first game, we knew they didn't really do anything special. We failed to cover the Mountain Dragon correctly in game one, and then our Herald play was really bad because Wild Turtle was basing for Bork on the same timing that we were moving up to defend, so we should have just given it. But we left the game snowball really hard off of those two plays, so it's just about taking it slow, maybe like one wave slower if you have the control, and just being able to play through that. And so we have priority this time around in two of our three lanes, so we're going to use that to break out the third lane and hopefully outscale and win and take a lead in the series. So,
well, looking forward to it. Best of luck to you and the team. Back to you guys.
I really like the recognition there from how they recognized what happened in game number one, saying, yeah, it was those two plays. That's what blew the entire game open. That was the snowball, because League of Legends often is such a contest of small things becoming huge after they have a chance to build up a little bit. And FlyQuest recognizing those mistakes and immediately rectifying them for game two is a good sign for this team.
Yeah, it really is. And I've got to say, that's probably the most detailed game plan I've ever heard from a coach in one of those interviews.
Yeah.
They're usually like, yep, pretty happy. We'll see how we do.
Happy with the draft. Hope we can win. Like, that was actually a really good answer. Other coaches watching, please tell us answers like this in the future.
I'm loving it. And you know, he's telling us, you know, he talks about they party in two lanes. So you're looking at the solo lanes to have some priority, to be able to actually take that down. And as he said, break out this third lane, which I assume is the bottom lane there for Turtle and JJ. So we'll see if they're going to be able to do that. And it kind of gives you this fun story to track. You know, when you hear the game plan from the coach himself, are they going to be able to execute on that? It's exciting.
Top side, Viper will shove in Haunter here nice and early. This matchup, you will expect it to just be Jay shoots Poppy a lot. That's the story of the top side laning phase.
But the twist, Poppy survives the shots very often and is able to kind of trade back later. You know, it is one of those situations where this is one of the best tank matchups, I would say, into the Jace. Poppy certainly can become very, very resilient, and if you want to build into things like Sunfire plus an Iceborne, you can get to the stage where you can just be dashing in onto the Jace and starting to really brawl with it.
Froggen losing out on some trades here in the mid lane against Pobelter, quickly finds some damage in return. Those Vel'Koz Qs hurt quite a lot, especially after he gets some items on him. You're gonna start to see big chunks out of squishy health bars.
Yeah, you really will. And anytime you can actually proc that passive, the bonus damage coming through from the organic deconstruction is really, really powerful. And we will see Froggen, at least for now, he is maxing the W as expected from solo lane Vel'Koz. And oh, Contracts just barely avoids that cocoon.
contracts will be taking some damage. Still forced to flash, even though the CC did not find its mark. Good job there, popping the summoner spell by Santorin.
Yeah, and that's because he used the flag and drag to actually go in, right, and clear out that camp. He did avoid the cocoon as a result, but then you have no way out, right? So the collapse was going to come faster from Pobelter, so he did have to flash. Does get one camp away from his opponent, but you certainly would prefer to have the summoner over one camp.
And you did point out that as this game goes on, FlyQuest have tank-busting properties in their vein to properly deal with this Poppy and Jarvan on the front line. But if you look across and see how things stack up for the other side, you've got the ability to throw Bowling Ball Galio into the middle of an enemy team and then back it up with a Vel'Koz ult against a squad that has no tank.
Yeah.
You've got a Braum.
They definitely don't have any true tank. The question just becomes, can you actually pin down and lock down this Vayne, who is going to have cleanse, who is going to be constantly tumbling around in invisibility? You know, that is going to be the true test for them. Yes, you'll have the initial taunt, but will you have CC to actually follow that up and kind of continue that march forward to killing off Turtle? It's also worth noting that Viper is not going Comet, is not going Ares, is not going, you know, anything that is more about the poke style. He is Conqueror. You're expecting him to go Black Cleaver, very likely into Blade of the Rune King, and be built for pure style split push.
It's the Poppy killer. Mm-hmm. That's the entire point behind what, how he's built, why he's built. He wants to make sure that that Poppy never hits the point that you were talking about, where it's just, oh, I'm Sunfire Iceborne, I'm a big wall, you can't do anything to me now. There's always going to be that true damage relevancy. As Viper takes a little bit of damage up there in the top side, would be a 2v2 if Golden Guardians decided to re-engage it. Monster just walks right back up. No fear. Cosplaying the Poppy here.
Yeah, he's a very, very brave man there walking up when Elise could have potentially come over, but they did have a ward in the brush, so he has some eyes on the spider and really wants to get the wave reset, because if you leave that wave in that position, Viper can essentially set up a freeze where so many of your minions are stacked up and actually denying the minions of your opponent, taking away that golden experience from yourself. So certainly something he wanted to deal with. They do have pretty good tracking with the scuttle, multiple wards in that river. So they are going to be able to have eyes on this spider for now as he, you know, crosses across that scuttle area. You can see the pings on the minimap coming out. And this is going to allow them a little bit more freedom to kind of play with Reckless Abandon, especially down on the bottom side of the map. You can see definitely opening up a pretty nice CS advantage for himself. Going to be going for an early reset, already grabbing a Cutlass, and you know, he's off to a pretty solid start here.
Yeah, remember Kalista, one of those champions that you're not going to see the traditional crit marksman type of build on, is going to be more of that on-hit Blade of the Ruin King into the Runan's Hurricane to begin with. You will get some crit to the Runan's, but it's all about just applying those bolts and those spears to everybody.
And this is actually pretty awkward. Olay stayed around to stop the recall coming out from Turtle. So now he couldn't actually fully, you know, push out the wave. He didn't actually have a recall timing to be able to answer. So now the wave will stack against Turtle and push towards Deathly, increasing that CS advantage, because so many of the FlyQuest bottom lane minions are going to be killing off the Golden Guardian minions and just increasing the experience advantage, which is very, very critical in this style of matchup, because if you are Deathly, you hit six first and go for some sort of a hard engage all in on the Vayne before he hits six, not really much of a chance to actually fight back as a Vayne.
The silver lining on that for Wild Turtle is the fact that despite the fact he's behind in lane right now, he still did hit the breakpoint for the Bilgewater Cutlass when he went back to shop, so he will have that item power spike as he returns to lane. Viper will continue shoving up here topside against Ponser's Poppy, but all things considered, Poppy's not too far behind in the matchup versus the Jace, and as long as you're not getting obliterated by Jace, as long as you can lose with grace in that lane, that's pretty much the goal.
Yeah, and Poppy certainly has the tools needed to do that, right? To be able to kind of play with parity, at least in the early stages. It does hit a certain point where, especially against Conqueror, it's so hard, you know, once he has Blade of the Rune King and Black Cleaver and all these items that are specifically built to deal with you, especially because there's an Elise and a Syndra, so you're going to have to build some magic resist at some point too, right? It makes it very, very tough.
Oh, Santorin happened to be walking by at just the right time as Contracts goes over that wall. Santorin nearly catches
out!
But Froggen with the Death Beam just destroys Pobelter.
Pobelter had both his summoners up there, underestimating the Vel'Koz damage, just goes down. But that was, you know, really good timing there from Santorin being around. We'll see if Contracts can get out now, because Deathly had already popped his ultimate to actually go in. Oh.
Of ultimates being popped. Not quite what Golden Guardians wanted there. Contracts not quite landing the knockup on the EQ combo onto Santorin's Elise, so the follow-up there from Ole wasn't quite what they wanted. However, because the enemy mid laner did get solo killed, that still means priority for Golden Guardians over the Drake Pit. They're going to be taking that one very low. It starts to reset a little bit. They'll need a little bit more damage to make sure they can secure this one. Secured over by Contract, but now where's the fight going to be popping off to? Frog is throwing a little bit of damage here into the mix. Wild Turtle going to be taken low. Hawster into the fight, looking to find the slam onto Turtle. Won't be able to get him, but grabs the kill anyway. Throwing JJ up in the air as Viper grabs a kill into Ole. FlyQuest still going to be looking for some more. Contract's not finding his way out. And FlyQuest grabbed 2-for-1.
Yeah, 2-for-1 there for FlyQuest. And what was a pretty intense battle. All members coming down. As Viper looking for more here. Flash still on Deathly, though.
Looking to make something else happen.
No flash on
but
Viper.
But Haunter still here means they will run him down. Spear after spear after spear. The man is a pincushion, Azale. And that is 2 kills, Golden Guardians.
Yeah. Viper just bit off way more than he could chew there. That was like a full health Deathly who still has sums. And Poppy is there as well. Here's the initial fight again one more time. Hovelter running back from base. They call for the TP. Both of them are coming in. Turtle rolling forward. The knockup does actually hit Santorin, but no knockup does hit on the Turtle. Then Flash knock into the wall. Monster looking for it. Turtle does flash away, but gets knocked down by the Poppy passive. And then on the other side, solo laners from FlyQuest knock down too. But then this was just a bridge too far. It's full health on the Poppy, full health plus overheal on Deathly. I don't really know what he thought he was going to get. It's not like there was even another carry there. It's a Braum with no health, no mana. So Viper gives away his summoner, gives away 2 kills.
I don't know if he just didn't see Haunter or what.
He may not have realized he was there, but you have to, you know, kind of do the due diligence to actually check and to track where those guys are. I don't think he had vision around that wall when he
right.
flashed in, certainly. But, you know, this is twice in 3 games where it's a critical mistake made by Viper, and we'll see if that does come back to bite them.
And this isn't just a mistake. It's a mistake in a matchup where it is imperative to stay ahead of the itemization curve of this Poppy. He's still only got components of Black Cleaver, first item not yet completed, versus the fully completed Sunfire Cape of the Poppy. Haunter is sitting pretty in this lane.
Yeah, he certainly is. And you can see Contracts is going for Warrior this time around. So he's going to have a higher amount of burst that he can put out. It's not the Cinder Hulk from last game.
Right.
This is due in part to the fact that they have a true tank now, right? They have the Poppy on their squad, so he doesn't necessarily need to act as that full-on frontline.
Not only did they have a true tank, once again, their opponents do not. No matter who he goes in on, if you can manage to land the EQ combo, follow it up with the Cataclysm, any sort of backup damage should be enough to make sure you get a kill out of that one. Santorin grabbing a very minute amount of damage onto Ole, who, along with Deathly, decides to get out of town, considering they would have been in a 3-versus-2. But that means, with the enemy jungler bottom side, Golden Guardians feels free to grab the Rift Herald. Hovelter gets himself away from Frog in there, who goes for the Lifeform Disintegration Ray yet again.
I mean, that was just a pure ultimate. He didn't hit the Q, he didn't hit a knockup, right? So
yep.
He's just utilizing it to actually get lane control. This is something we used to see a lot when Orianna was super, super common, is people would actually just ult essentially for the pressure in lane. And, you know, he's pushing him back, he's getting chip damage on the tower. Despite the fact that farm is even, it feels like the reverse roles from last time around where we saw Pobelter bullying on the Swain, you know, Pobelter getting that chip against the Lissandra. So, you know, roles have reversed a little bit here. And Golden Guardians is the one with the early advantage. They're the ones with the early dragon here also.
Froggen has a lot of money in his pocket. Once he goes back to base, he will be able to buy the Ludens Echo, which, as with any champion, is a massive power spike, but yeah. Especially for an artillery mage, it's going to be that much more important because it makes every single one of those pieces of poke that much stronger.
Yeah, it certainly does. And it's someone that, as you say, on that artillery mage, has the ability to consistently proc that, right? From long range, at safety, can be very, very strong. And it is Merc Treads here into another Cloth Armor. So I'm going to be interested to see if Haunter wants to go straight into a Glacial Shroud and that Iceborne second. It does make you quite susceptible to the Elise, to the Syndra. But, you know, a lot of tank players feel comfortable in that when you're playing against burst magic damage players like the Syndra, like the Elise, just building health is often enough to discourage them from actually committing their damage to you. Because, you know, can FlyQuest win a fight if Syndra is having to ult the Poppy, even if the Poppy dies? That remains to be seen, but usually it's not a good sign.
If every cooldown from Elise and Syndra goes on to a Poppy, who's stopping Froggen?
Yeah.
Who's stopping Deathly? Who's going to actually take these guys out? And I guess you could say, well, Wild Turtle, but Turtle's also got a lot to deal with in terms of contracts and Ole trying to put him in the dunk bucket every team fight. This is not what you want to ideally do. And now the Rift Herald will be summoned up here in the mid lane. It is still pre-14 minutes. Shelly, you've got 20 seconds, and you're only going to need three of them. Wham, bam, thank you, ma'am. Cash in pocket for Golden Guardians. Contract's going to be in some trouble. There comes Ole, looking to probably keep him safe, but will not be able to find it just yet. Centaurin getting himself away. Lifeform Disintegration Ray over the wall. The heal is not enough. Good lord, man, Vel'Koz does damage.
Yep, and from such long range, and not only did they get the turret plates out with, you know, well-used Rift Herald there, they get first turret straight off the back of it, and then it looks like, okay, well, Contracts kind of messed up, got caught out, does die, but they're able to trade a kill there, get first turret gold onto Froggen also, so the extended play, certainly very nice, as Contracts is expecting those members to be defending the turret, not to be defending the race. So he says, hey, I'll take an easy camp instead. Surprise, JJ and Santorin go in, but then Froggen over the wall. Ultimate comes through. Bang, bang, does get the kill.
Just absolutely deletes him from Summoner's Rift, going one for one on that one, and taking the mid lane turret with three plates worth of gold on it is a big win there for the Golden Guardians. Now up 2,500 gold, 7-1. On plates taken. Remember, every two plates you have over your opponent is about a kill's worth of gold. So imagine Golden Guardians have three more kills to their name. A game that's 3-8 looks much more serious than a game that's 3-5, as Golden Guardians will now also grab themselves another Drake. Two clouds is a lot of movement.
Yep. These are all true things that you're saying. Eight
I know.
Kills is more than five.
I took math class, Adele.
More than one.
Yep. We got all
sorts
of
go fast.
Big numbers rolling in here for the side of Golden Guardians, who are trying to hold on to the top lane turret. Haunster doesn't exactly want to walk within Viper's firing range because Viper does have that cleaver, but he'll walk up enough to defend the turret.
And mostly that interaction, you're going to think, as Pobolter
back
again. That looks pretty silly. You're like, well, why is the Poppy just hiding? That is because they did not know where Elise was. And also, we did see, you know, some members missing elsewhere on the map. So he was actually more afraid of stepping forward and dying to a dive there. You know, not just potentially about that 1v1, and until they get eyes on Santorin, which now happens, now Haunster knows he can actually fight for it, but it's not worth him dying and giving over a potential bounty kill to that Jace while they are pressuring elsewhere. So he's playing weak side of the map, and you can see as soon as Santorin was spotted, he moves forward again. And this is kind of just that push and pull that you see in pro play, and it's one of the things that, you know, these pro player top laners are actually so good at playing around.
Tier 1 turrets will be traded across bottom and top side. It's Golden Guardians taking bottom, FlyQuest taking top. Top side, you can see the Poppy still managing to hold the line right now. Farm is dead even. I commented earlier that when it comes to Jace, it's just trying to lose gracefully. Why lose gracefully when you can win? He's up one CS. This is exactly where Poppy wants to
be. One CS, we take those.
We take those all day long for Golden Guardians. Haunster, comfortable up there. You can see the Sheen and Glacial Shroud in inventory means Iceborne Gauntlet will be the number two pickup. Wants to make sure he's ready to fight in that side lane, keep Viper under control.
Yeah, and I think it is a smart play when the guy is itemizing so heavily and his rune choice is so heavily towards actually beating you. You do need to give respect to that and build appropriately for that 1v1 matchup so you can hold on as long as possible. And I do think that because it's not a Cassio or an Azir or someone that has that consistent damage, just building health on a third item may be enough instead of even going for something like a Cowl. You can often even go for like a Warmogs or even a Randuin's and just have enough of a health bank to sit back there as
Froggen does this every time. He fires out Q, then immediately presses R. If Q misses, you take off half his health. Oh, well, whatever. Alt doesn't have that long of a cooldown. If Q hits, you send him home, sometimes with a black and white screen.
Yep. It's very, very scary. I mean, really, all Vel'Koz needs is a knockup. The knockup confirms your W and your ultimate is going to come through. And if they don't have flash, you can often 100-0 most carries with just that combo. It does require really good positioning to play Vel'Koz, though, because while you can do that to your opponents can do that to you because you are very squishy. You have no true escapes or dashes or ways to kind of, you know, get out of there if they do get on top of you. So I think it's a perfect Froggen champion. When you heard the desk talking about how adept he was at staying safe and how hard he was to kill, I'm talking about that on the Karthus. Well, hey, this is a similar style of play where, you know, it's about controlling space, similar to the Anivia, similar to the Karthus, and he's just so strong at that style.
I don't want to see Froggen on the Popsicle Queen. I want to see him on the little space squid Space making laser. Some plays happen in the mid lane, but bottom side is Viper once again, keeping Haunter underneath the turret. This turret has a lot of health to work with, though. Again, Haunter very tanky up against this Jace, but one thing he's not tanky against is this Elise. Santorin considering the possibility of making the play here.
Yeah, it's tough, though, because you want to say, okay, if it's just the Poppy there, we can do this. If someone else is behind him, you probably can't. So now with the face check, they're going to try.
Haunter loses half his health immediately to that Elise. Wants to go over the wall. Uses the Keeper's Verdict, but it's going to be sidestep. Very nice from Santorin. And there's the cash in.
Santorin playing that so cleanly. Repel instantly to follow the Poppy over the wall. Then he flashes over the Keeper's Verdict there, over the ultimate to get the execution. That is the kind of play you want to see from your superstar jungler.
This is the kind of play that pulls me apart, Azale, because I don't know whether to call it clean or dirty. It was both at once, and it's playing with my heartstrings right now. But Santorin and FlyQuest have to be ecstatic about the way that one turned out. Not only do you grab the kill and the shutdown money, but you give Viper free firing time on this turret, which he should be able to take down here. As Froggen loses half his HP in the mid lane there, Pobelter getting some damage.
I mean, that's what I'm talking about. You can do that to your opponent, but that wasn't even Syndra's ultimate, right? If the ultimate comes through, you just die there. Here this is one more time. A Haunter doesn't have the vision, unfortunately for him. Face check straight into the cocoon. Gets first down so fast because he has no MR. It is double flat pen onto Santorin, and then follow this. E over the wall. Haunter is making the correct play to knock him out right as he comes in, but instead Santorin flashes over top of him. Beautifully executed, gets the shutdown as well. 550 gold in the Spider's bank.
Perfect execution from Viper there. Don't worry, bro, I won't KS you. We're just gonna get him down to one HP so your red buff finishes it off. Passes the gold over to the man who made the whole thing happen. Golden Guardians, onto their third elemental Drake of the game. Third Cloud now, that is a fast team.
Yeah, that is Usain Bolt levels of speed at this point. When you get the triple, you are going so fast, and it does make it actually very difficult to be able to kite out and kind of escape some of these side lane matchups. You know, when you are the Jace, Triple Cloud is actually very scary. You're supposed to be pressing and playing forward, but if Jarvan shows up, Poppy can even potentially try to chase you down. Some of your kind of kiting potential is certainly reduced, and the map movements are going to be that much stronger as well from someone like Olay, who wants to be running around and looking for ultimate opportunities. But I do want to see Golden Guardians continue to push the pace because they are the ones playing with Kalista Galio. I do feel like 2-3 items is kind of the strongest part of the game for the Kalista. So yeah. You want to see them trying to pressure around objectives. You have the Kalista for the additional spear secure, where you can rend down and smite at the same time. And you also have really good turn and engage if someone comes and face checks that. So Golden Guardians need to establish vision control around this Baron area. But for now, it is FlyQuest with all the wards all along this river, really in this whole area. And they're going to have to clear that out and then set up potential picks or potential threats on that Baron.
One thing about FlyQuest, Turtle still one item away from full build, has to make sure that he has the Rage Blade along with the Blade of the Ruined King on the Vayne. So once that comes online, this team will really be able to pop off in those team fights. But until then, you are at the mercy of this Kalista, which, as you pointed out, really spikes up there in the mid game, especially when you have Olay that you can throw into the fight with those big taunts and try to get everybody all at once.
And I mean, if you're someone without Flash, J4 plus Galio engage, and they're just starting this up, bring them in, look for the turn. This is a smart play.
Good answer.
At the very least, they should be able to force out Viper's teleport here, but they're looking for potentially a big fight.
Froggen's positioning is great too. He's on the back of this cliff. He's going to be protected by terrain, and he funnels them all into that corridor. If the laser comes through, it's going to do massive damage to everybody on the side of FlyQuest. More skill shots connecting. Golden Guardian staying on the Baron, bringing it down to about 1/3 HP. Lifeform Disintegration Ray coming out, forcing everyone back.
God.
So much damage onto the health bars of FlyQuest. Keeper's Verdict going to be used to keep them all away. Baron's still only at 3,000 HP. Golden Guardians could still possibly lose this, but they're not willing to give it away just yet. It's going to be secured by Haunter. And now Golden Guardians have to try to get out. Contracts over the wall with the EQ combo, and it's well executed. Golden Guardians grab a 22-minute Baron.
I absolutely love the force there, because if FlyQuest fully commits in through that small corridor, they will get shredded. They will get turned on by a flash taunt, by an ulted Galio coming in on you. So Golden Guardians just leaves two or three members hitting that Baron while the rest of the squad is actually zoning them, because Kalista's stacking up those spears, getting ready to rend that down. They do secure it. and put themselves in a great spot because not only did they get the Baron, they got Viper's TP out as well. So now Hotzer has TP advantage as the kind of team fight squad here on Golden Guardians. They're going to be feeling really good about their spot in this game now.
I mean, you have the best neutral objective securing AD carry in the game. You also have one of the best objective protecting mid laners in the game with the Vel'Koz. The whole strategy was set up perfectly for this, and I love the fact that they wanted to go for it. They had the confidence in each other and in the call to make that one happen, and now they're rewarded with a Baron up push top lane.
And they didn't even feel like they needed to wait for perfect vision, and I think, you know, in retrospect, that is the correct call, right? They had the inside track, and now gonna be knocking down this turret. Viper is committed to split push. Remember, Viper has no TP, so you can potentially 5v4 dive knowing that Viper cannot actually get there to respond in time, so he's gonna have to come back to base and try to group up with his team, which is not where he wants to be playing the game.
Absolutely not, especially not, as we already mentioned, with that strict split push build. Golden Guardians continuing to push. Four men here in the top side. Not gonna find anything with the plasma fission this time here for Froggen, but that Q's on about a 5-second cooldown, so you can rest assured more are coming.
Yep, exactly, and they just had to buy time here for Hauntzer, who is pushing in mid-wave. They want to try to get these waves synced up so you can have multiple crashing at the same time. Right now, they are not in a position to actually get that going. So it's going to be off and up to Froggen to try to hit some poke, to try to push them back off the turret, and then allow Deathly to step forward and try to siege, because Calista is a low-range marksman and does have to put herself in range of Syndra and Elise to actually auto the turret.
More poke will continue to fly out. Lots of plasma lasers and buckets of chicken. Heading towards the health bars of FlyQuest. Plasma Fission finding its way onto JJ there. As you can see, Contracts rotating over towards the mid lane, trying to help Hauntzer, apply some pressure onto that one.
And it looks like Golden Guardians are actually just gonna be content to go back towards the Infernal Dragon. That is coming up in a couple seconds. So they fully push in this last mid lane wave, and they will work their way over to the Infernal, and this should really be uncontestable for FlyQuest to actually just walk blind over there. The dragon should be gone before you get there, and if you just kind of face check into this team, you will get engaged on.
And Froggen has the Book of Confidence in his inventory. Medjai Soul Stealer. He's saying, all right, this is the kind of game where I'm not going to be getting any more deaths, and we're just going to win it based off of this. Infernal Drake secured means even more damage in the Golden Guardians' pockets. They've got Baron for another 15 seconds or so, and they're going to try to run it down mid, see if maybe they can grab something off of this one. Everybody's here. The whole crew came to party. Hauntzer only about two-thirds HP. Contracts is already going in. Life Focus Integration Ray into the FlyQuest lines. Froggen goes on a killing spree, putting another couple of pages in Magi's as Golden Guardians will break the base.
Really nicely done. They're so decisive, and then just rejecting Pobelter out with the Poppy ultimate coming out of that Zhonya's. They get the kill. They will take the inhibitor here.
Or will they? Almost.
They will, I think.
There we go. One more auto attack does it. Hauntzer gets himself away with a steadfast presence, and Golden Guardians make sure they break that base with the Baron.
Very, very well done by them. Next dragon will be Infernal. Another hotly contested dragon there that Golden Guardians are going to want to take, and FlyQuest are going to want to prevent them from getting that five dragon lead. Here's the play one more time. They see members on the side. They see that they're not all together. So Contracts says, yep, in we go. Flash ultimate, Galio to follow that up. Life form disintegration ray from long range. And then just knocking Pobelter out there before they can really fully retaliate. Maybe could have killed Pobelter, but it would have been more risky to go for it. So they do just send him out, take the inhibitor, take the kill, and cement their lead even further. Now picking up additional items, third items coming through for both the soul laners. You have the Zhonya's to be able to shut down any potential dive coming in on Froggen. Can use that very effectively against Syndra's ultimate to actually stop most of the damage coming through from there. And these guys are just getting stronger and stronger. Definitely as well, gonna be so hard to burst down. He has QSS plus Hex Drinker, which I think is very intelligent when really, who's going to reach you? Who's going to be the one that kills you? Very often, it will be Pobelter and Santorin, and that's about it. Because if Jace tries to dive into this team, into a Galio, into the Poppy with that steadfast presence to stun you up on your jump, it's going to be very, very difficult to get anything done.
Plus, this isn't like last game. You don't have Lissandra as your mid laner, who's there as sort of this, like, AP bruiser diver thing.
Yeah.
You have full damage in terms of Froggen and this Vel'Koz, who's going to put plenty of DPS into these enemy lines, so you can go for a more defensive option and not really feel guilty about it. Baron spawning in 35 seconds means Golden Guardians want to move in and set down some control wards, take control over this area. Last time they did it without the perfect vision, but doing it with is even more preferable. Lifeform Disintegration Ray fired off. FlyQuest manages to actually avoid that one pretty well without taking a whole lot of unnecessary damage. Santorin's going to lose about 25%, but that's not too bad. Nice buffering of the EQ there to escape the Elise Cocoon despite the fact that it connects. Contracts a little bit injured now. Plasma Fission still going to continue to fly. Remember, if Golden Guardians go for this, they do not have the Frog and Ultimate. Vel'Koz ulti cooldown's pretty short. It's only 60 seconds, but that's still another 35 or so you have to buy.
Yep, they want to push one more wave. They want to clear out this last wave here from Golden Guardians. Then I think they will go over to that Baron. Defroggen didn't get the best chunk with his ultimate, but enough of that wave is now cleared out. They can just go and actually look to potentially start it up. And yeah, definitely is on it. They're two-maining the Baron right now. Those spears are stacking up, preparing for a potential Ren. No more minions to continue the mid lane siege. So this three-man squad trying to zone here.
Froggen's ulti still 10 seconds away. Plasma Fission's being fired off. Blue Trinket gets placed down. Olay's gonna go ahead and remove that one. Froggen trying to keep himself safe from FlyQuest. Doesn't want to be flashed over the wall on.
They are
Monster
split,
still in the pit. Lifeform Disintegration Ray goes off again. But once again, it's not going to find the numbers Golden Guardians are hoping for. FlyQuest still healthy enough to contest.
Yeah, and the Baron did reset there. This friend stacks did fall out. So they are going back in on this. But here comes Pobelter.
FlyQuest trying to fight for it. They're looking to go in. Ole's able to find a taunt onto two. JJ going to be taken very low. Turtle nearly kill out. Bursted down. Taken out of the picture. And that's a double kill over to Deathly. Over the wall goes Pobelter. Golden Guardians still 5 men alive. And they say, leave us alone. We came for Baron. Y'all head home. We'll see you in a minute.
Yep, they're going to get it. Very nicely done. Again, so dominant around these neutral objectives. They can reset. Infernal's up in 30. That is essentially perfect timing to go and grab another Infernal to add to their collection. They are getting monstrously strong here. And Golden Guardians closing in on match point. FlyQuest feel they need to make the contest. They do move in. You can see the squad going in. Flash ultimate comes out from JJ, but it misses Froggen. And Olay is there with the taunt on multiple members, taunting Turtle, taunting JJ. The cleanse comes out from Vayne, but he is already out of that. Gets locked down, knocked down. Really good peeling from Olay, keeping Froggen safe. And if you keep that space laser safe, he is going to reward you with lots and lots of damage.
Unfortunately, cleanse doesn't cleanse a bunch of rocks being built around you by a Jarvan Cataclysm. So Wild Turtle can't get out of that one.
Spell.
Yeah, you need to be able to dig out of the mountain, but unfortunately, the technology just isn't there yet. Golden Guardians now pushing down this bottom lane. They got everybody down here. Mid lane inhibitor still down for another 10 seconds or so. Once that respawns, that of course is something else Golden Guardians can fight on in open ground.
And critically, no more supers will be spawning here in that mid lane. So they're just gonna walk up though, bold as you like. FlyQuest not feeling that they can actually fight for this. And if you have to just seed the inhibitor tower, you are really close to just seeding the game. If they can't engage there, they're gonna give up both of those inhibitors. The top lane is pushing. Golden Guardians just gonna go around the horn here and look to finish this out. That final inhibitor tower is very low. FlyQuest will have to choose their moment, look for something, but engaging forward into a Vel'Koz, into the Galio, and J4 and Poppy create so much space feels like a Herculean task, and we'll see if they're going to be up to it.
I feel like the fight has to happen here if it's going to happen. Inhibitor turret number 3 falls. FlyQuest still no opportunity to go in, no opportunity to engage.
Yeah.
Inhibitor number 3 continues to take auto attack after auto attack. And Golden Guardians have found that one as well. It's 4.5 minutes of double supers in every lane. The map belongs to Golden Guardians. Santorin loses half his HP from a little bit of poke from Froggen.
And I mean, if you can't contest at any of your inhibitors, can you even contest at the Nexus turrets when there's 6 supers crashing in per wave? Golden Guardians just gonna stick around, Baron buff these up, and look, they just close this one out. Froggen is getting kind of low, though, from that Jace poke, so that may be a way in.
Well, Contrax has found his way in. There comes your dunk bucket, and that's going to be the kill onto Pobelter. Golden Guardians keep themselves in a really good spot. Glacial Fissure finally going to find the Lifeform Disintegration Ray Interruption. Can Turtle find some sort of an outplay here? No, sir! He'll be taken out, but at least there's a couple down on the side of Golden Guardians now. It will not be enough. FlyQuest retreats. The fountain's their only salvation, but they will not find it today. A double kill over to Haunter. Santorin's the last man standing, but Golden Guardians are on to the Nexus itself.
Santorin will try to hold them off. The knockup comes through from Froggen. The slam into the wall. The ace for Golden Guardians. And they'll take it to match point.
Golden Guardians from back-to-back 10th. Now one game away from semifinals here. Two dominant victories. Feels like they are really finding their stride.
Let's not undersell the comeback story either. Not only back-to-back 10th, back-to-back 10th and a really rough start this split. This team is bouncing back incredibly. One more game sends them to the semifinals, could potentially send them up against the likes of Team Liquid or Cloud9. They have to play one of those top two teams, but they are looking like contenders right now.
They really are looking so, so strong. And you've got to say the difference between Froggen playing these sort of team fight mages, high DPS champions is so massive between him on that and him on Lissandra. It's a world of difference. And him and his Karthus and Vel'Koz games, he's been absolutely crushing it. A lot of Haunter was part of this game too. I mean, Haunter deserves a ton of credit for his Poppy performance. 5-1-2, he was pretty much everywhere, it felt like.
Yeah, when you see Froggen, you want to see him on these big damage picks. You want to see him on these things where his performance can just make or break a team fight, because that's where he really shines. And speaking of team fights, let's go ahead and take a look at the replay of the second Baron fight that happened between these two teams.
Yep, this was the game ender. JJ looking for Froggen there, not able to find him. JJ and Turtle diving forward, but look at Santorin, look at Viper. They were already chunked out. They could not follow up. The Braum ultimate didn't even hit onto the Vel'Koz, and that simply meant there was not enough left in the tank to be able to get through the Galio, through the Poppy, this massive frontline who has so much peeling and shutdown. And then here, in the base, looking to close it out. In goes Galio, Poppy, Jarvan, on to Syndra. Hobelter had no flash, no way out. Turtle makes you think, hey, maybe they can do it for a second here as him and Viper do go in, cleaning up a couple. But there's enough left over from Frog and Olay and Haunter to close this one out, and they get the kills at the end to do it as well.
Very nicely done from Golden Guardians. And going back to the draft, we saw the first half of the draft be the same as game number two, which went very poorly for Golden Guardians. But the changes they made to that second half, starting with grabbing the Kalista before there was the opportunity to ban it out, also including FlyQuest not banning away the Poppy, Golden Guardians being able to put Haunter on that, it was just what the doctor ordered.
It really was. And I think that you could see how well they played around these neutral objectives with the Kalista. They were so confident using Kalista and the Vel'Koz, those two major changes to be able to play around Baron. Vel'Koz is zoning, Vel'Koz is poking and pushing them off, while Kalista is preparing to actually secure the objective with those tanks. And I think this was a really good swap up for Golden Guardians in this draft. And despite how confident Invert has been in these sideline reports, you have to be a little bit nervous now. You are at match point for Golden Guardians. You only have, you know, you have no games to give, right? You have to win two straight as FlyQuest to be able to kind of keep your hopes alive. And they were the favorites that most people had coming into the series.
To be fair, though, they bounced back very well between games one and two. Game one, they got smashed. Mm-hmm. Game two, they did a wonderful job coming back, utilizing the Swain, making things really happen. Golden Guardians made some errors, constantly trying to go in on that Swain. Their plan seemed a little bit shaky, but now they've rebounded here in game three. And this one's going to get intense. We're going on a break, but on the other side, High and Crumbs put on their coaching hats in a dueling draft to preview game number four. You don't want to miss it.